On June 19, 1996, 17-year-old George Colazzo was murdered in the South Bronx. Two eyewitnesses looked at mugshots and identified the same man as the murder suspect.
We have witnesses. Once someone picks them out, they pick them out.
Richard Rosario, then a 20-year-old husband and father of two.
We have people IDing him, saying he definitely did the shooting.
Rosario voluntarily spoke with the police, insisting he was 1,000 miles away in Florida on the day of the murder. And yet...
they said, we still got to take you down to the precinct and question you down there. And I left with them.
Rosario says he handed over the names and numbers of 13 people who could confirm his whereabouts, including his close friend, John Torres, now a sheriff's deputy in Florida.
It is 1,000% impossible for Richard to have committed that crime. There's no way. He can't be in New York and Florida at the same time.
Despite these alibis, Rosario was charged and convicted of first-degree murder and sentenced to 25 years to life in prison.
I'm innocent, and I'm always be innocent, no matter what the justice system does.
His story caught the attention of Dateline NBC supervising producer Dan Slepian, who spent years looking into Rosario's claim of innocence.
All I care about is the facts. So if you're actually innocent, the facts can't hurt you. The facts can only help you.
Absolutely.
Now, in a 7-episode podcast called 13 Alibis, Slepian uncovers shocking revelations.
He gave a statement to the police and gave them names and addresses and phone numbers, including yours. Did anybody ever call you?
Not a single phone call. No one from NYPD called me just to confirm if what he was saying was true.
Unbelievable.
It seems unbelievable. Dateline NBC supervising producer Dan Slepian joins us now, along with John Torres, one of Richard Rosario's 13 alibi witnesses. Guys, good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for
joining
us. Thanks for having us.
So, Dan, you started investigating this in 2014, covering it for Dateline. And you speak with these witnesses. You must have been kind of incredulous that this was an issue when you've got 13, including a sheriff's deputy, who say he was someplace else.
Exactly. I mean, that was the first thing that really surprised me about this, was the sheer number of witnesses. 13 seemed like a lot to me. But perhaps more important, after I spoke with them, was their credibility. You know, I've been investigating claims of innocence for many years, and oftentimes when you speak with witnesses, they might not remember, they might have credibility issues of their own. But on Richard's list of witnesses, the first one was John Torres, and that was the first guy I spoke to. And when I did, as he'll tell you in a second, he had a very specific reason as to why he remembered, like the other alibi witnesses, that Richard was down there. And so that really raised the ante for me, because one of two things was true. Either Richard was innocent, or I had a law enforcement officer lying to me, which was another podcast.
That's what I don't understand. Yeah. So you're now a sheriff's deputy,
correct?
Right. Don't you think, even just fellow law enforcement, you give them a call and say, hey, how are you 100% certain that he didn't commit this crime? What happened for you?
Well, for me, when I first heard about it, I was almost relieved that they said that it was the 19th, when I heard that it was the 19th, because I knew I could account for that date.
Why?
Well, because my son, I was preparing to be a father for the first time. My son was born on June 20th.
Wow.
And the thing about it was, my wife was being induced to go into labor on the 20th. So we knew she was going into labor that morning on the 20th. And Richard was talking to me about what to expect for my firstborn.
So, Dan, you talked with the original detective who took down the list, the alibi list. What did he tell you?
Well, yeah, after I spoke with the alibi witnesses, they all told me that no one from the NYPD or the DA's office or anybody ever called them. I wanted to know why. So I looked at Richard's list of 13 alibi witnesses, and I looked at the signature at the bottom of the detective who took that statement. He was not the lead detective. He was part of the team. And he let me record our interview, and I went and spoke with him. And he said, when he found out, and I told him no one ever spoke with these people, he was surprised. And I think his exact quote was, if that wasn't done, I think something was left out.
So we know how this ends, full disclosure, obviously, but because the podcast is so compelling in this moment, we don't want to give it away. But I am curious for you, when you're covering a story like this, what makes you say, you know what, something in you feels like, you know, you want to help, you want to figure this out, help him get to the bottom of this.
It's an excellent question, and each case is different. For this one, it's the simplicity of it all.
Yeah.
It's either he was in Florida or he was in New York, and I thought, we can get to the bottom of that fairly easily. But what happened was, is after I spoke with the alibi witnesses, as I said, it raised the ante, and what happened after that was what was really shocking when I spoke with the other people.
You also spoke with the victim's sister.
I did.
What did she tell you?
She was very interesting. I mean, she was very upset. Interestingly enough, when her brother was murdered, she wanted to speak with Richard once he was arrested as the guy who she believed did this. So she went to Rikers Island to visit him. And she spoke with him, and she was very turned off by his demeanor. He was very angry with her. And she concluded he was guilty. But she told me something else, that she had a completely different, even though she thought Richard was guilty, she had a completely different theory of the crime than the police had laid out, which led me on a whole other direction, as you'll hear in the podcast. Wow,
it's really fascinating. People need to listen. Dan, John, thank you so much. The Richard Rosario case being chronicled in the brand new Dateline NBC podcast, 13 Alibis, which you can find on any podcast platform. Don't listen alone. We'll be right back.